30초 남았습니다.
A lot of fans on both sides. A sold-out audience here at the Seoul East Stadium.
Well, sold out a week ago, Achilles. People were hyped, you know, not just for the top lane, because there's so many stars on the Rift whose paths haven't really crossed outside of international tournaments in a few years. Well, it's forever Renekton. We know exactly what's happening here. Level 3 is going to be the pain train. If Spirit goes top, which you have to imagine Spirit is going to have to try and get this Renekton going, Marin's Renekton was something to be feared at 2015 Worlds, but his reputation as a player took a big dive over in China, didn't make much happen on LGD, and Renekton is seen as too risky to make work in most matchups. So let's see if the Master can make the Apprentice finally respect him, because it was Smeb having a field day in Game 1.
Just gonna go ahead and start this off. Of course, sporting the SK Telecom skin, because why the hell not?
He earned that skin.
They all did.
His MVP skin from Worlds, so, you know, now's the time. I look to try and put his team on the back, put his team on his back, but tough ask against Smeb's Jace.
We'll have to keep our eyes on that matchup yet again.
Pawn's using Easy Hunas here.
Yeah, you get the double SKT skins coming through.
On both sides. On different sides, sorry. So, that's fun.
So we'll see who is better, Easy Hoon or Marin. But already just going to be some light trading back and forth in the bottom lane. Like you mentioned, that level 3 is definitely going to be the interesting spot here for the top lane. Score, maybe looking for a roam up already, if not just the Scuttle Crab.
Well, he wants to relieve pressure from his Jace. He knows the only way this goes bad for Jace is that early all-in and early gank, so got a crab vision will certainly be another factor to deter the Olaf from coming in.
Not sure how long Marin has left on his ward coming up. He's kind of faked down into the river to make it look like he placed one, but score's coming up. Marin doesn't see this yet. He's on the opposite side. He gets smacked back, dashes through, won't get knocked up by score. They get on top of him. Flash forward, the knockup comes through. Couple more hits, flash to the side. Smeb comes up with the first blood, takes him out with a shock blast. You can see Marin, he's getting all hyped up here. He's like, all right, that's how it's gonna be.
But it's just too easy, Achilles. Marin and his overextending at level 2, level 3 is legendary. The matchup dictated that he wanted to get a big early start. Didn't get it. Teleports in, sure. Doesn't miss a lot of minions. But you can only fall so far behind as a Renekton before you're literally useless. So see if there's a return gank, because they now know that summoners are down for Marin.
It's gonna be nice times here for Smeb. Comes back. Second Doran's blade as well as a long sword. Both will have refillable potions, but Marin, it's going to be quite some time before he can even try to optimize for any damage. Death, though, going to be taking a lot. He has to flash away. You can see those Voidlings really hurting him.
And the solo queue Malzahar supports need to take note that Exhaust is by far the best summoner spell you can take on Malzahar from an offensive point of view, just because you exhaust the enemy AD carry, you guarantee the Voidlings get in and multiply, and his Spirit is trying on Smeb. Remember, Smeb no flash.
Yes, Smeb going to go ahead and get locked up by the stun, trying to trade some damage back, but can't do a whole lot. He will go down, so another kill traded over in the top lane. This time, a Freak of Freaks put one on the board.
Such an important one. The steadier for the top lane. Renekton desperately needed to be on the board with some sort of advantage. We'll also be able to push in the minion wave. And actually, over the course, we'll win out on this trade just because he teleported in and got the experience under the turret. Smeb teleported in to continue to try and run the lane and will thus miss many more creeps than Marin.
For now, though, looks like all the lanes having a considerably better time on the side of a Freak of Freaks. No real CS discrepancies coming through. Big wave here available for Koro that he can pick up. That'll pretty much just equalize the CS count, if not give him a little bit of a bump. Looks like he might just be down by one at the end of this. But, I mean, even Kramer in the bottom lane having a much better time. Dodges out. Piercing Arrow still gets hit by that Mantra Q, but again, seems like things have steadied for a Freak of Freaks. So,
and we kind of gave Tucson and Kramer a free pass for losing lane in a good matchup in game one. It's a tough ask against Deft and Mata in particular, but want to see them at least go even in this matchup. Early game, Varus and Karma will always beat out this Ashe and Malzahar duo, but level 6. It's when all Malzahar lanes turn.
See Score kind of fishing around for a gank in mid. Come on.
It's the wave ultimate farm lane.
Yep, just going to be a lot of back and forth. Double Doran's waves for both of them so they can maintain their spells. So not going to be looking for any real aggression yet. I mean, we could see a Shreema shuffle come through into a pushback and have Score follow up with a knockup, but won't be there quite yet. Score roams up to top. It's warded out, so Marin will see this one coming from a mile away.
Yeah, start of rushed boots too as well.
Oh, he's going to go forward. Gets onto Smeb. It's a little bit of damage in. Smeb's low on mana, and the wave's pushing up, so he won't be able to get into melee form to gain any of that back.
So the theory there was that Smeb wanted to test if there was a ward, because he knew that if there wasn't a ward, the second dash from Renekton would have been aggressive. He would have gone for the all-in trade with the Fervor. But because he went for a trade and then went out, it basically guarantees there's a ward there. Otherwise, he would just not have played so passively, just given the opening that Jace gave a Renekton.
See where they want to go. Marn so far is going to be opting into armor. You can see the Ninja Tavi is there for him. Smeb likely going to see a Black Cleaver come through. Could be the Yoma's Ghostblade, but I feel like he'll want a little bit of extra meat on his bones for that health he'll get from the Phage.
Yes, lead opening up in bot, but nothing to write home about just yet. Much more muted start, which suits both teams, specifically Afrika, who just want more time on the Rift before things are taken to 11 like they were in Game 1.
Yeah, and I mean, you really have to wonder, thinking back to Game 1, how would that game have transpired if it wasn't for that red buff steal coming through from Smeb right at the start?
It would certainly have been a lot more resistance at the many invades made by Ivern, that's for sure.
Maybe we would still see Mowgli here in Game 2, you never know. This could be KT fighting from the back foot, but either way, Afrika having a considerably better time at the moment. But KT, they want to be able to close this out at 2-0. So they can keep ahead of SK Telecom in game score. So far, it's been nothing but 2-0 victories for both of them.
We're going to put a foot wrong for sure, Achilles. Nice trade for Marin.
He got the Q at the end, but he does sidestep the Shock Blast. Won't get caught by that. Smeb was mostly in it for the minions. So he'll be all right. TP's coming back up. Likely we'll have to pop that to get back to lane, so he doesn't get denied at ACS. We'll see if he wants to run this out. Looks like he actually will.
And how KT play out a comp like this when they don't have an early lead or even a pressure point in any lane that you could point to is a really exciting thing to track. We've seen them play these poke comps from ahead. They get the aggressive vision in. They take the shorter distance between turrets because they can move aggressively through Fog of War. And a big gold lead erupts. We're not seeing that in this game. They're 500 gold ahead. The start has been a lot more muted, and you're seeing defensive itemization. It's a Merc Tread rush by Pawn, just so he doesn't get locked up. A bit more resistance to magic damage as well. KT feel the pinch this time. It's very much more of a slow start. So it's just really exciting, even just as an analyst, seeing how you play out a comp like KT's when you're not with a big snowball.
Still is this Renekton factor, though. Kind of wait him out until he's not as impactful as he could be.
It's a good backup ball carrier, irrespective of how much damage he's doing.
That's true. Could dash, double dash through. But so far, it's just been slow and steady. Wins the race. And at the moment, Afrika Freaks are inching out very slightly. Likely due to this slight CS lead coming through for Koro, but so, game is very close from both sides.
It's fun to see Marin just play the champions he's known for. Rumble, Kennen, Renekton, returned to his 2015 champion pool and made it work in the new meta. Has at least survived laning phase. Thanks a lot to the nice gank from Spirit, which stopped the snowball from happening in top. Orianna versus Azir is complete non-interaction. Azir being out of the meta took away these farm lanes, but
Oh, he's going to go in for it. Misses the ultimate. Flashes away from the shockwave, and that went completely sideways for Pwn. Still gets a bit of trade damage back onto Kuro, but misses the scoop.
He basically donated his flash to the Freak of Freaks for no gain whatsoever.
But now Spirit walking in. He's going to pop the Ragnarok, trying to get on top of Pwn as best as he can. He goes low, throws one more axe. That'll be it. Kuro actually finishes him off. But here comes Bada. The tether will be flashed away by Kuro, so will not connect. And now the Nethergrass comes down on his score, flashes up the wall. But the Lethic Vision still ticking. And Marin
exhaust,
here trying to pick him up. Score. Can he make it out of there? Hits the blast cone, but it does not matter. Tucson comes up with the kill. Two more on the board for Freak of Freaks.
Yeah, they managed to aggro the walls, which might have actually got the last hit. I don't think the last auto attack did enough. Regardless, kill comes through. 2-for-1. Slight advantage of Freaka.
Take a look at this one. So Spirit does pay for this with his life. But
I mean, he saw Pwn use everything, so he's like, all right, this is the time when we can finally kill the Azir. The teleport looks good, but it's canceled by Jace, and that's why Renekton showing up is actually a big factor. Smeb incorrectly thought the fight was completely over. Would he have got anything done? Probably not. Yeah, aggroed onto the walls that did the final bit of damage.
You know, he had a tunnel right there, but he couldn't see. He just, I guess he couldn't see it. He didn't know that it was there already. Could have just taken that for a ride over into the blue pit, but instead, score goes down.
Health bars were such that perhaps a Jace teleport wouldn't have mattered. It was just very clear in that replay that the canceled teleport and Renekton being in the right spot meant a lot for Afrika.
Yep, and now things looking quite good for the Afrika Freak squad. If they could just keep this rolling.
The comp has clear win conditions. The one in game one we mentioned from behind couldn't really do anything because it didn't have a lot of initiation. Now you have two ball carriers for the Orianna and an Ashe for the ranged initiation. Plus, Kuro's done well. 11 CS up. Has kill involvements as well.
And Kramer as well. He's also been swinging a bit of a gold lead, a CS lead rather. Oh, and Spirit gets the Scuttle Crab.
Force Deft into very defensive itemization. QSS is his first real completed item next to the Serrated Dirk. Almost certainly going to be the same build that Prey was running in the Longzhu series that we had first, which is the pure AD caster build. So we start off the season with Essence Reaver into Hurricane being the standard.
Oh.
Well, Mata is dead.
All right. We'll have to get a replay of that one to see how this transpired. But
Mata thought he could ward, and he could not.
We could take a an educated guess.
Feels like the pure caster build that we saw in other regions now become the popular one for Varus.
Yep. Vision cleared out on the blue buff. Looks like Spirit and Tucson will stick around to take this away. Score is waiting in the wings. Can he get the smite is going to be the question. Spirits is just now coming off cooldown. Could be a little bit of a smite war. Goes low. Looks like score is going to come out on top, but yeah, not going to pursue any deeper for that kill. Spirit will just go ahead, cut his losses.
See up top. Marin's doing very well. So, you know, basically neck and neck with Smeb's Jace. And Tucson camping the brush. The Malzahar has given a lot of value to bot. The early exhaust blowing Death's Flash meant that he had to play so much more defensively in lane than he was able to in game one. Made up Essence Reaver for Kramer, no other items.
Yep. And neither team looking to commit too hard because they just don't want to. I mean, KT especially don't want to give up. Any more of a lead, and yet Mata just trying to walk into enemy territory.
I mean, game one, that was fine. They had enough pressure that you could make those warding plays, but it's just disrespectful play in an even game like this one. The moment he saw Olaf, he knew he was dead. Didn't matter what summoners he had up.
Well, KT now fighting from the back foot.
But is it enough to justify the Renekton pick that Marin has managed to go even in lane with a Jace? Because Poppy, theoretically, sure would have had a CS discrepancy, but is Poppy in the late game, which is something to be feared. Poppy was available. Went with his own wheelhouse. It means that early game they're not bleeding gold, and they just lost a game where they bled gold and the game was thusly decided. But we have to keep track, because again, it is still Renekton in the late game, and poachers may vary on whether that matters at all in terms of team fights. Unless you're just monstrously ahead.
At the moment, the Freak of Freaks are not. I mean, they're comfortably ahead for 15 minutes, but not to the point where they can know, really be comfortable with the Renekton and feel that satisfied over it.
I mean, the counter argument is that the enemy team has Jace, who isn't a team fighter in his own way, does offer more options in Siege. So if they get a pick and then have the Jace wailing away again on a turret, then certainly you get a lot of value there. How the Renekton is played is going to be very, very interesting.
I mean, short range skirmishes, he dashes forward, he gets that W stun out. Could be a guaranteed Ash arrow.
But you look at the enemy team, who is in range of even a flash dash W? Talking about Jace, who's off the screen, Shaw, Rek'Sai, but Rek'Sai's whatever, Azir, Varus, Karma, like all these are very long range champions. So
true.
Seeing Renekton close the distance, unless they're so far ahead that it doesn't matter that the enemy has to face check. Just trying to quantify what Renekton brings to an Afrika victory, I think, is a very interesting thought experiment. So far, it's meant that the turret HP for Afrika in the top lane is higher than most champions will be able to do against a Jace. It's almost full health, which not many champions can kind of hope to do in a Jace lane.
KT fighting from the back foot. We'll see what their next move is going to be. We can see Pawn walking forward, standing on a ward. Tucson and Kuro do see him. Flash is available with another grasp. But looks like they might have been spotted walking into that brush.
From Marn to maybe flash over as well. Nice spotted out.
Yep, score coming through. They'll see Marn. So not going to be finding Pawn this time around. That will just keep the waves moving up. He's got a little bit of a lead back. It'll be a small one. But hasn't been able to get on top of that turret and really hammer it down.
And the item build's pretty much the same between Marin and Smeb. Smeb will from here itemize more into armor, whereas it's going to very much be standard DPS build from Smeb.
Oh boy, here we go. They did find him in the end. Shockwave comes through. Spirit arrives right at the end to help take him out. And that is Pawn going down. So patience pays off for Afrika Freaks. They invested a lot of time into getting that kill, but they got it in the end.
So they basically had Deft go the super respectful build of QSS before any completed items. And Pawn is saying, okay, in a team fight, I'm never going to be in range of Malzahar, so I can't afford to build QSS because our item time is going to be so far behind. But the penalty is nice rotations, and now Score eats an arrow.
Arrow comes through, Score getting locked up, and that's going to be Marin dashing in. Shield comes through, trying to keep him alive, and now Marin's going to have to head for the hills. Deft trying to cut him off on the backside. Last
big chain of corruption.
Done, but the chain of corruption connects onto Kramer, but he doesn't suffer much damage for it. Piercing arrow does come through. Score dashing over the side, looking for an in. Has the flash, but he's still really weak. And Spirit is just zoning back the Rek'Sai. Turret goes down. Afrika Freaks will go ahead and profit for that one. First brick picked up.
Deft actually looking for an exit kill on Tucson. Doesn't find it. There could have been so many casualties for Afrika if they overstayed any more than they did. With a numbers advantage, they were able to hold true. KT will get an Ocean Drake. It's not a massive factor, but given that we might have some very drawn-out poke wars, the regen could be relevant.
Yep, you can see Smeb and Martin kind of playing ring around the Rosie for a second there, but Smeb says, you know what? I'm probably not going to kill you. I need to get the CS. You are free to go. But Afrika Freaks, they push forward. They net themselves a turret. They get a kill on Pawn. They just keep the ball rolling. And KT just have to react. They can't make the plays. They have to respond to the ones that Afrika is pushing onto them.
They're going to continue to wait. They continue to let Azir get items. I don't think it's a mistake not to go QSS by Pawn. A lot of people be like, he's been caught now twice. Why no QSS? Going to go over the back end of this fight where multiple members from Afrika could have gone down, but they ended up getting the turret. The reason why I say that is that I don't think you can afford to have two people go QSS. You just need to play more defensively as Pawn to justify your more offensive item choices. So the mistake is more stepping up when Malzahar is off the map than not rushing the QSS.
Just an Ocean Drake for KT so far. Only objective they've been able to net themselves. Pawn, of course, you know, turret goes down, but he still has that passive that he can kick in. Try to keep himself a little bit safe.
Makes the map more narrow. And we talk about the advantage of getting the outer mid lane turret is that you open up the map and vision with those minions pushing in for invades for both blue and red side vision. But the Azir turret negates all of that, at least temporarily.
definitely a different Freak of Freaks here in Game 2, especially due to Spirit being able to get onto that Olaf that he is just so comfortable on. 1-1-4, he's got 100% kill contribution at the moment. And score, that's going to be another grass coming through onto him. Spirit trying to lock him up, has a Ragnarok score. He's going to have to flash the wall, the Blood Vision sticking down, the Axe connects. Can he make it out of here? Big shield and move speed burst to try to get him to safety. Axe will barely miss, as will the volley, and it looks like Afrika is going to have to go ahead and peel back off of this one. TP's used by both top laners, so they will not be able to join the fray.
Such a different game when Afrika Freaks in many lanes do have, at minimum, equal pressure, and in some places are actually winning the pressure game. It's only now that Smeb, for the first time at 21 minutes, is being able to auto-attack his enemy top lane turret. There was very, very early turret takes in game one where K2 were able to pick up the pace. Now they're getting punished whenever they try to make map plays that were so clean and easy with the lead they had in game one.
Yep. Definitely going to be, you know, the toughest game that they've played through so far. Games in the past that KT have played, you know, 2-0 over Rox, over BBQ, and then Longju, who were definitely struggling at the time. They showed a bit of a firmer form in our first match of the day, but you know, those were easier matchups for KT Rolster. Everyone's still been saying, you know, best if not second best team here in Korea under or alongside SK Telecom. But now a Freak of Freaks with Spirit back in. Marin not overextending early.
I mean, if you watch the games, I think SKT looked on a level above KT. Clearly their records were the same, 6-0 for both teams, but SKT had little to no weakness, whereas KT kind of just chilled their way through games with little opposition, so they kind of got to play themselves into form. And you're right, this is the toughest ask, at least this particular game. Close second will be Longju game one, where Longju had a really good start and then fell away.
And then Depth woke up on Ezreal.
Such champion in this case. QSS is taken by Pawn, so they want some map pressure. They want to be able to walk up, but build delayed for Pawn in the mid lane. Maybe should have been rushed, hard to say. Could have been Stinger into the QSS if he wanted to play up in lane, and maybe it's a non-factor now, because now we will see team fighting phases where Pawn will be significantly outranging the Afrika lineup. So it might have just been 1250 gold misspent.
I'll have to see. I mean, he already showed that big miss on the stream of shuffle, trying to get the kill in the mid lane. So can't afford to have any more of that when it comes to these team fights. Pawn has to be the playmaker on this Azir. That's the reason why you pick this champion. Create those big openings, the big divide between members of Afrika Freaks. And if you can't pull it off, then things are not going to be good for KT, and they might suffer their first game loss. Still a ways away, gold lead. Not stretching too far, 2,700 in favor of Afrika Freaks at 24 minutes. So KT definitely still in this, but they need to be able to net themselves an objective. So far, it's just been the Ocean Drake, hasn't garnered them much. They need to take a tower.
Jace is very close to doing that, has the enemy turret down to about a fifth health, maybe lower. This is the build that Smeb goes against difficult tank matchups. He's the only person I've seen straight up win 1v1 Jace vs. Poppy at two items by going the Black Cleaver into Lord Dominic's Regard build, maybe even the Yomu's third to continue along that train. So we'll actually be doing decent chip damage, if not actually having a one rotation kill potential on Marin.
Yep. He's got an all magic mantle, could go a couple different ways. I would expect QSS. It's going to be, I was going to say the Hexdrinker perhaps, but it could be the QSS for the Nethergrasp.
Is a champion from the top lane that can itemize quite naturally into something like the Mercurial Scimitar. So it doesn't really throw behind his build that much. As you say, could be the Hex Drinker, but the only magic damage you're really negating there is the Shockwave in terms of burst, Shockwave into Dissonance. So maybe Edge of the Night actually will be a consideration. Then you can walk up, Siege for 10 seconds and back off. Fits the build a lot cleaner because you just build it out of Serrated Dirt.
Very true. Might be able to find out on this next back. See, top laners just swapping down to bottom. Just going to start working on that turret. And give the opportunity for Depth and Mata to maybe take that turret in the top lane. Spirit, you can see, Pretty tanky on the Olaf. Not going to take a whole lot of damage. Almost has a Guardian Angel ready to go. He's going to go ahead, pop that Righteous Glory. Sprinting in onto Death. Nethergrass comes through from Doucet. That is one dead Varus. Koro able to pick up the kill, and a Freak of Freaks just keep applying the pressure. KT, they just can't find a way out of this hole.
Yeah, this blue side buff is becoming a reality for the Freak of Freaks. Do have to deal with Smeb in a sideline, who now is pretty significantly winning these trades against Marin. So that's a potential headache, but that's the only a small asterisk on what has otherwise been really clean rotational play. KT have a comp that plays best from ahead, and they are certainly nowhere near ahead. All three outer turrets are down at a mark where KT realistically would want theirs down. Only a Jace outpushing a Renekton is what they have to show for their early game.
Yep. Now Second Drake will go over to a Freak of Freaks, so just netting everything that they can. Come up with that kill. Cloud taken out. Looks like it's going to be a Mountain as our third. And that could really help out either side. KT with this siege composition would love to have that added damage, but just haven't been in a position to really contest over anything. Still no turrets going down. You can see Spore keeping the wave pushed forward. Get a little bit of damage in, but I don't think he's going to be able to stick around. He's already going to go ahead and hightail it out of here. The Ash Arrow doesn't connect, but still respects Tucson even without the Nethergrasp.
With mid turret down, they also have the extra movement or lack of restriction on the map to...
That does fall in the end. Minions. Good old minions.
The ultimate equalizer. No rumble in this game, we can say that.
Boy, though, Death Plata, they're pushed pretty far forward for not having a turret, but you can see they do have some vision in the river as well as Score hovering nearby.
Definitely saw on that last turret dive that Olaf is still the answer for a mobile AD carries. QSS, Flash, neither were enough to stop the onslaught from Olaf. This has been a Spirit-only pick so far in LCK Spring. A lot of people thought, myself included, that with Courage of the Colossus and basically then not being a realistic Keystone Mastery for Olaf to take that really fit in his wheelhouse, that Olaf would fall away. But Olaf finds a way back into the meta. And it's been very, very effective so far this game.
Yeah, I mean, it seems like this blue buff and this Olaf might go hand in hand, because I believe it's two wins so far for Spirit with this Olaf out of their three that they've had. So, you know, combining that with the blue side, I mean, granted, blue side allows them to get the Olaf a little bit easier, but seems like it's a good combination for a Freak of Freaks. But that does cause, that is a little bit of a cause for concern in this series, because if they do win this and they take us to game three, then they have to win for the first time on red side.
I mean, just everything's working here for a Freak of Freaks. The draft was a lot better than the game one draft. Red side usually gives more drop tools, so you think it'd be better as Smeb finally might be caught.
Yeah, he gets jumped on. Crow's going to go ahead and pops him right away.
No vision at all. Smeb far too far extended in the bot side.
Trying to get on to Spirit. Pops the Righteous Glory. We'll get that nice slow coming through. And he'll just Ragnarok his way to safety. Kramer there to back up. Doesn't even need to toss out the Crystalline Arrow. And now Marn and Kuro. Going to get a lot of damage onto this tier 2, if not just the whole thing. That's going to be Pawn going forward. Pushes Spirit back. Tries to get onto Kramer. Zoss comes through, but he's just not able to lock him up. Nethergrass coming out. QSS off by Pawn. A lot of going low. Pawn just trying to kite back up the lane, but here comes Marn Kuro to cut them off. That's going to be Pawn going down as Kuro finishes him off with the ball movement. And Depth and Score have to run for the hills. A Freak of Freaks is blowing this game wide open. Three kills picked up and looking like a tier two in mid. This could translate into so many more things. They can rotate back down the bottom. They can take the Baron. The world is their oyster at the moment. The Freak of Freaks, they are not letting go.
And you have to say, Pawn is not making us a believer of the Azir. His Azirsec plays, his Shurima shuffles, whatever you want to call it, have been wayward at best, costing his team in more cases. He would have had his Flash Exhaust being able to play defensively, but went for an all-in, missed it, and then was just too far overextended. So if you're going to play Azir, you need to be a master of the champion, as Bjergsen was able to show in NA. But got flashed, and if that one trick doesn't work, there's nothing left for Pawn really to do in this situation. If you're winning, if you're just a late game Azir with five items, free hitting from the backline, sure, Azir does have very good late game damage. But if you have to make the plays and the plays don't register when your team's behind, then it doesn't really achieve very much.
Yeah. I think this was a very bold-faced pick. Just not playing, not playing out here. Smep will be able to knock down this turret. Now they try to get onto Marin. A lot of armor shed from Smep, but he goes low. Ultimate there from Marin, ticking away at him. They'll just come up with the turret. Meanwhile, Pawn getting caught in mid lane, cleanses that off immediately. And he'll dash his way to safety, but the tier one turret in mid will be standing still.
And we do have to take a breath and evaluate the KT have about as much wave clear as you could ever ask for with Jace, Azir, Varus, Karma, like so much range wave clear that all the easy objectives, it seems, will roll given how the game has been going. And they have some turret dive options, but one of those turret dives goes wrong, the game pace starts to change a little bit. So this game's definitely not over till a Freaker can break the base. And breaking the base is an exercise in frustration against what KT has drafted.
Now though, things definitely going their way. You can see the vision control coming out around Baron as we're 31 and a half minutes in. Haven't seen that become a point of contention quite yet. It's been all about the dragons for either side. Our third spawning just in 40 seconds here. Now Smeb getting chased on, gonna try to run up the lane, but yet again, severe lack of vision. Looks like Spirit's actually not gonna cut through the jungle. Doesn't have much vision himself, and the Ash Arrow won't hit.
Optimistic.
So Smeb, he will be able to hightail it out of there. Yeah, looks like Kramer wasn't really compensating for the additional move speed you get from swapping stances. So just a slight little miss there. Would have certainly come up with a kill had it connected. But Afrika just being respectful. They don't have vision in that blue side jungle at the moment. They didn't want to go chasing in just for a kill on this map, only to lose multiple members. So showing restraint, even when they're ahead, that is a very good sign for Afrika Freaks.
And one of the big things to consider there is that when you have Renekton, you know, in a very comfortable position against Jace, where Jace has to overextend just to farm, if you send multiple members bot side, you lose Baron control. And having Baron control, having double, triple control wards around Baron that sticks for a few minutes, means that Baron becomes that objective you can take if ever Renekton is ganked in the bot lane. So given where the game is at, where Baron might actually be able to empower the turret dive that would end the game. So I think playing around Baron is what Afrika need to do. It's what they've been strong at. I mentioned that Tucson, and specifically his peeling on Malzahar, has been something to note. That given that breaking the base is so hard with the wave clear we've talked about, never give up the Baron dance. That's really your biggest way to win this game.
The tower there getting chunked down. Depp maybe getting jumped on. Marn goes in, finds the stun on Damada, who goes low. Does he have a shield to keep himself alive? Looks like he won't even need it. The flash away is coming through from multiple members of KT, though. And Smeb, he'll get caught. That's going to be both he and Mata going down in the end. The Freak of Freaks find the kills. That's a lot of wave clear taken off the board. Where do they want to go? Could just rotate over to this Baron. But looks like they want to stick in. Tucson getting low. Score pops him up. He's able to come up with the kill, but he's getting ticked down. Looks like he might lose his Guardian Angel. Tunnels over the wall. Will make it out safely. KT, they're able to trade one back, but they still lost two and their turret.
There was some positioning mistake from KT. What you saw there was that Pawn peeled off with Death to be able to provide the peel specifically for the Varus. But that meant that Jace was caught in the open. Renekton could just run at two members, zone them, and they had good target selection. If it's a three-man core, if it's Varus, Jace, and Azir, Renekton has no answer for the ultimate from Azir. So in that case, because of the split, KT fell behind a little bit. They got one answering kill. They don't lose any objective other than an outer turret. So yeah, lots used on Deft. Nice cleanse comes in instantly.
Well,
and then Marin runs straight at Deft, and because Pawn is so far out of position, the ultimate there doesn't provide anything. He doesn't actually ult during this entire fight, and that's why they can just continue two melee champions to run at someone like a Jace, something like Varus. That shouldn't be possible with the Azir.
KT trying to turn up the heat. You can see them pushing forward, but they don't get any damage in onto this tower. The wave clear is still there from the side of Afrika Freaks. Kuro can do well with the dissonance. Kramer has that hurricane, so they don't have to worry about a whole lot here on the side of KT Rolster. Freak's just going to be hiding down. I'll wrap around. Just go ahead, concede this turret in the end. As it looks to be that way. No, then maybe they do want to defend this one. Score's going to get locked up. TP coming into the backside from Marin. Who's he going to pick? Tucson's already gone down, and Smeb takes him out of the fight, but Death falls as well. Spirit snatching that one up. They jump on the Smeb. They burn him out. Score on the run. just has the GA still trying to keep him alive. Looks like he, Mata, and Pawn will be able to retreat successfully. The double dash coming through from Marn, Slice and Dice, trying to get on top of him. They will do so. Guardian Angel gets popped. Can they finish him off, or does he have a tunnel to get out? There we go. Big burst of damage to Dissonance mixed in with Kramer, and they get rid of score. 45 seconds on that death timer. They're going to rotate straight over to Baron. They have 15 on Tucson. They can delay the kill until he spawns and have a full five buffs.
And the teleport from Marn was really what was needed for a Freaker to win a fight. As KT, you do not have the option to actually go into short range. You will eventually just not be able to close distance because you don't have a frontline tank. You don't have someone to get on top of Kramer. And the moment that Jace is dying in the strafe, consider the options for KT. The moment that Marin shows up behind them, they basically have to go for kills because there's no way to go back. You can't just peel back and use the Emperor's Divide to open up space so they can just focus whatever target Kramer goes on. People will die. So actually getting that deep teleport, no options left for KT. They're lucky to only lose a couple of members.
Yeah. Good dashing there by Marin. Getting that double slice and dice and spear just continually pounding. And you can see he's pretty excited there.
And that sort of play doesn't happen in game one, not because of the picks, but because they never lost turrets. Basically, there was no deep teleports for a tank to come into, given that the poke comp, which is very similar to what KT's running in game two, was hitting all their timings. When you miss your timings as a poke comp, you inevitably will be overextended the first time that you set up around a turret. That was the case for KT there. The lead continues to inch forward for Afrika.
I mean, do you think that there's really any hope for KT at this point in this game, or are they gonna be able to bounce back, or are they gonna suffer their first game loss? Because as it stands at the moment, it's nearly 10,000 gold. It's just off by a few hundred. 10 kills up, a Mountain Drake as well. It just seems like there's not much KT can do.
I think there is a chance. It's a remote one. Getting picks like this would be a good start.
Trying to find Koro, they do pop him up with the Rek'Sai. He throws out the Shockwave, but it barely does any damage, and they're able to take him out, so nicely done by KT. But now the fast track onto this inhibitor turret is there for Afrika Freaks, as well as the tier 2 getting knocked down, so it looks like they will net more from this. Clear from Death, desperately trying to get through these Baron-empowered minions as quickly as he can, but won't be able to find much in the end. Score goes forward, trying to scout out with that Tremor Sense as best as possible. But it seems like KT are just going to be on the short end of the stick yet again. They shove down mid, looking for that Tier 1. Should be able to find it, but now they have an open inhibitor, and they lost a Tier 2 in top.
Just to return to your point, as they have the inside track to mid lane and will take, finally, the mid out of turret. The only reason I give KT a semblance of hope
is
that hope might be gone now.
This is really aggressive from Score. Goes in on the Spirit. They chunk him down to half HP. Smeb will smack him away, so there's no more follow-up. Ashero connects. Score is able to tunnel out to safety. Looks like that might just be the disengage.
Give KT a chance.
You've been playing League of Legends for an hour.
Yeah, it's very interesting how in 7.1 that Korean text that pops up when you play here pops up. I've been spectating for quite a while, Killius. Not 60 minutes in this game, but certainly cumulatively much more. You give them a hope because 6-item Azir can do everything, can peel, can damage, can take out the backline while also peeling for the frontline. So because it's Azir, I give KT an outside chance. I think a poke comp with any other mid laner would have zero chance at this point. Azir's unique in as a champion, even at the current balance level, where that can happen, but it requires the perfect fight, and it requires a Freaker to misplay. So, a remote chance, but an outside chance for KT.
So these wards desperately being thrown down, so KT can know when a Freaker starts up that Elder Dragon, but they say no. I'm just gonna keep sweeping these out. You have no chance. Take this one away. Ash Arrow comes through. Really good cleanse off by Depp.
Turbo Ola.
Spirit, yeah, just dashing his way in. The Ragnarok does get popped, and he doesn't find much. So now goes down. Marin, he'll get spotted. Does he want to commit in for the fight? Looks like the answer might be a no. Chain of Corruption comes through, but Depp gets jumped onto the backline. Big Shockwave comes through from the Orianna, and that is going to be Depp going down, followed by Score. Two swift kills picked up here for Afrika Freaks, and Pawn is gonna follow suit. One more shot would do it. Marin cutting him off with the TP. He'll go down in the end. An interrupt from Smeb won't do a damn thing. Four members fall, and Afrika Freaks looks like they've finally done it. Smeb will not be able to stop this. This should be the game going over to them. They'll lose Tucson on the back side. But a Freak of Freaks, they can just shatter the base and take the Nexus.
And they will be the first team to actually inflict a defeat, a single game defeat onto KT's otherwise perfect record. Remember, this team did take down Samsung, even if they lost to MVP, to really make us, okay, how good is Afrika? Judging by this game, pretty damn good, Achilleos.
Absolutely. Whether it's the blue side buff, whether it's the all-up, we do not know, but Afrika Freaks finally take a game off of KT Rolster, which will give the upper hand to SK Telecom moving forward if they can keep their series clean. But now, can Afrika Freaks close out this game? That is the question. If they could do so, it'd be devastating to KT.
And I just want to know who has the trump card in this. Who's got that extra something special? It was the Ivern in game one. It was the return of the Renekton in game two. It felt like the draft really shaped both games. I want to see both teams show us their best and give us a third game worth riding home for, because it's been an exciting series. We all thought it was going to be 2-0 after the way game one went, but Afrika picked themselves up. They are veterans. They don't have young players now that Mowgli's out of the lineup to really have to baby. These guys have all been up there in important matches, and they came through in this game.
Yeah, they did. Significantly slower paced, but Afrika, they played it to a T. They knew their win conditions, and they just had it work well. You can see the squad is starting to really mesh, looking much more cohesive compared to their set against MVP, which they lost 1-2. Now it's a game off KT Rolster, but need to close out the series.
Yeah. All eyes on the second round of the draft on red side. There should be so many things Afrika can do with their drafts that they haven't been doing in previous games. So I want to see them get winning matchups, round out a solid team comp with win conditions. They couldn't do that in game one. They haven't done it much on red side. Let's see if they can pick it up for game three.
Yep. And KT have to expect they won't be coming into this third one with as much overconfence as you might be able to say. That Azir pick in mid, completely useless for Pawn. Did not impact a single thing in that game. So we'll see what they cook up. We're going to go to a quick break. When we come back, we'll have our third and final game of the night.